dismiss all of our teenagers is, where's Billy? I don't see Billy. Is Billy here? Let's give it up for Billy. Billy, I want you to come up here real quick. It's up to you. I mean, not a big deal, not a big shameful thing. So as you know that Billy has graciously stepped in to help us out in our youth ministry in an interim position. And so we are excited. We have sat down with Billy. We have drilled him. We have questioned him. We have beaten him. No, I'm just kidding. We didn't do that. But we are excited to announce that Billy is now our permanent youth director here. And so I would like to call his family to come up here real quick. Girls, you can come. Absolutely. And then I'm going to ask the elders to come up here as well to join me. We're going to pray over you, brother, all right? Because you're leading our teenagers and you need prayer, okay? This is his amazing and beautiful family, his girls. Be careful. They're wrestlers, all of them. And so they'll take you out. So we're gonna lay hands on him. Everybody put your hands out towards Billy and his family. So Father, we praise you and thank you, God, for this man. We thank you for the calling on his heart, Lord. We thank you, Father, that he is the one who's going to be leading our teenagers, God. Father, they desperately need you. And Father, we thank you, God, that you've called him to be our guy. So Lord, I just ask, God, that you put a hedge of protection around him and his family. Protect him from the attack of the enemy. Father, we pray, God, that you speak volumes through him, Lord. I pray, God, that you give him wisdom beyond his own wisdom, Father. I pray that you give him understanding. I pray, God, that he would be a man who would listen, God, and that you would just move through him. And so I just ask, God, for more encouragement. Father, we pray, God, for our youth ministry here at Living Water. We ask, God, that he would grow even more. And so, Father, I just thank you, God, that you've called this man to be the leader of our youth ministry. And God, and we just know that you've got big plans, Father. I love his dreams, God. I love the vision that he has, Lord. And so, Father, I pray, God, that we would rally around him as his church, his family, and God, make these things happen. So we sure do love you. We sure do praise you. We just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's give it up for Billy. So with that being said, for those of you who are in the grades of 7th through 12th grade, we ask that you would just follow Billy as he takes you up off to youth ministry. And so if you're in that age, just follow him. And let's give it up for those who are in that age. Absolutely. Yes. In fact, we are so excited that our youth ministry is growing that we actually had to move them up to the second floor for a bigger room. How cool is that? That's cool, right? That's an amen part. You can say amen if amen. Awesome. Listen, let's continue on in our time of worship as we read God's word. So I encourage you to open up your Bibles, go to Matthew chapter 7. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 6 today. So Matthew 7, 1 through 6. And as you're doing that, turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus looks good on you.
Jesus looks good on you.
And then say, I mean it this time. So Matthew 7, verses 1 through 6, if you got it, say amen. Amen. If you need a minute, say give me a minute. All right. Time up. All right. I got my minutes fast. So if you got it, say amen.
Amen.
Let's stand as we read God's word. As we do to honor his word, we stand before it. So Matthew chapter 7, starting in verse 1, says, do not judge. Say, do not judge.
Do not judge.
Do not judge so that you won't be judged. For you will be judged in the same standard with which you judge others, and you will be measured by the same measure you use. Why do you look at the splinter in your brother's eye, but don't notice the beam of wood in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take that splinter out of your eye, and look, there's a beam of wood in your own eye. Hypocrite. First, take the beam of wood out of your eye, and then you will see clearly to take the splinter out of your brother's eye. Don't give what is holy to dogs, or toss your pearls before pigs, or they will trample them under their feet, turn and tear you to pieces. Heavenly Father, we sure do love you. Father, we ask God that you would guide us and lead us. Father, we ask God that you would speak to us right now, that you would remove all distractions from us, Lord, that we'd be totally focused on your word right now and what it will do to us. We're expecting to be transformed. So, Father, I pray that you open up our eyes that we would see your word more clearly. And Father, I pray that you'd open up our ears so that we can hear your word more clearly. And Father, I pray that you open up our hearts so we can feel your word more clearly. God, it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may have a seat. Now, as you sit down, turn to three people and say, let God be the judge of that.
Let God be the judge of that.
I wish you could hear it from my part when I say, let God be the judge of that. Some of you are like, let God be the... Never mind. Matthew chapter 5. In the book of Matthew chapters 5 through 7, we see Jesus giving the Sermon on a Mount. And in this time, Jesus is up on a mountain with his disciples and others, and he is giving this sermon. This is one of the recorded sermons that we have of Jesus, and it's three chapters long. In fact, it didn't take an hour or 30 minutes. It actually took days for Jesus to give this sermon. So I think that on behalf of what Jesus did, this is going to be a three-day sermon today. So here's the thing. So in this sermon, he explained what the kingdom is and how it works and what it ought to look like. So here we are. We're jumping towards the end of Jesus' sermon, coming to the part where he is talking about how we should not be judging others. I remember when I was in high school, I was a junior, maybe a senior in high school, and I went with one of my friends with his youth group to Minnesota to go check out this college, you know, because as a high schooler, you got to be prepared for college. And we went to this place called Crown College. So I crawl into this van with a bunch of teenagers, and this kid gets on board on the van, and this dude is loud, right? And he's dressed militant, and he was just a different dude, right? And as he came in, he had this gigantic cooler full of cabbage burgers. Anybody love cabbage burgers in here?
Yeah.
So Jesus, we pray that you would just fill these meals. Cabbage burgers has this distinct smell, right?
Oh yeah.
You cabbage burger lovers? Does it not? Right? It has a smell. And man, every time you opened up that cooler, it was like, we had to roll windows down. It was horrible. But his mom gave him like a week's worth of cabbage burgers. Right? So here's this kid who's loud, dressed militant. He's just a different guy. Giving the aroma of cabbage burgers, right? That's just what it is. And here's the thing. I didn't know this guy. I didn't know this kid. And here's the thing. I didn't care to. But the thing was, is that as I spent more time with this kid, as I spent more time with this guy, and I got to know him, I actually started to realize that he's a pretty amazing guy. And here's the question. Aren't we quick? Aren't we quick with assumptions and judgments about people before we truly know them?
Yeah, it's true.
We are, aren't we? It's in our nature. This is what we do. But Jesus tells us that we should not judge others. But check this out. Let's break down those verses that we looked at today in Matthew 7. Let's break those down. Let's look at verses 1 through 2 here. And it says this. It says, do not judge. Say, do not judge.
Do not judge.
Turn to your neighbor and say, do not judge.
Do not judge.
It says, do not judge so you won't be judged. For you will be judged by the same standard with which you judge others. And you will be measured by the same measure you use. When you look at the word judge means this. It means to pass sentence or punishment or to condemn. And so basically, in these two verses right here, Jesus is saying, who made you judge? Listen, how we judge others is the same standard of how we are going to be judged. So the question is, are you a good judge of character? Here's another question. Do you think that you're a fair judge? You know what? I think I judge that pretty well. You know what? That person over there, I think I'm a good judge of character. Listen, what Jesus is saying here is to legitimately judge is to create your own standard of what is acceptable and then measure everyone against it. So the traits that bother us in others are often the habits that we dislike in ourselves. So if you're ready to criticize somebody, you better check yourself before you wreck yourself. I don't know who quoted that, but I love it. If we're going to be ready to criticize someone, we better check ourselves before I wreck ourselves. And then we need to ask ourselves, do I deserve the same criticism? Psalm 119, verse 66 says, teach me. Say, teach me.
Teach me.
Say, teach me.
Teach me.
It says, teach me good judgment and discernment, for I rely on your commands. We need to be saying, when it comes to this moment of judging, we need to say, God, I need you to teach me how to rely on you, and I need you to teach me discernment. Trudy and I have these neighbors who moved in across the street from our house about 4 or 5 years ago. Okay? No, maybe 3 or 4 years ago. They moved across the street. And listen, no matter what I do, I cannot get them to acknowledge me. I will walk by and I'll say, hey, neighbor. And they do this. I will wave to them. I'll do jumping jacks. Hey, look at me, look at me. Hey, you. You too. No, they won't even wave back to me. I know they see me. I think that I'm a pretty friendly guy, right? So I'm wondering what's going on here. What's up? But here's the thing. I do not know if they're unfriendly or not because I don't know. I don't know what's going on with them, right? All I know is that they're a tough crowd. So all I say is, challenge accepted. I'm going to make cookies and I'm going to bring it over. My name is Jason. I'm going to lend waves to you all the time. And you don't acknowledge me. God, it hurts my feelings a little bit. James 4:11 says this, do not criticize one another. Brothers and sisters, anyone who defames or judges a fellow believer defames and judges the law. If you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver and judge who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you to judge your neighbor? There, listen, only God is the lawgiver. Say, only God.
Only God.
And only God is the judge. Say, only God. So when did we decide that we can be the judge of our neighbors? Who is our neighbor? Our neighbor is your neighbor. Or it could be a coworker, or it could be a family member, or it could actually be somebody that you are sitting next to right now. But listen, we have no idea what's going on in their lives. We do not know what's happening in their lives. So instead of being the judge, maybe we should love them like Jesus. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 17, it says this, therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God now commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has set a day when he is going to judge the world in righteousness by the man he has appointed. He has provided proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. Listen, our Heavenly Father is the only judge. And I'm sure that I don't want to be judged on how I have judged others. I might just get judged with cabbage burgers. Because listen, the Bible tells us, right, what we see here in Acts 17, that there will come a time when we will be face to face with our Heavenly Father, and he will know everything that we have done. And he will judge us buy those things. And there is a price that has to be paid for those things. But then Jesus went to the cross. Say, but Jesus.
But Jesus.
So in Romans 10, 9 through 13, it says this. It says, when you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. One believes with the heart, resulting in righteousness, and one confesses with the mouth, resulting in salvation. For the scripture says, everyone, say everyone.
Everyone
who believes on him will not be put to shame, since there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, because the same Lord of all richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone, say everyone. For everyone who calls on the Lord will be saved. Jesus took care of our debt. He paid for our sins on the cross. He paid our sins. He paid the sins for you, and he paid the sins for me. He paid the sins for us. The Bible tells us in John 3:16 that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Verse 17 says that he came into the world to save the world and not to condemn the world. The Bible tells us in Romans that sin separates us from God and that there is a price that has to be paid because of our sins. Right? And so Jesus came and took our punishment on the cross, and he died for all of our sins. I don't know, but 2,000 years ago, I don't know if you were alive back then, but he thought of you when you were on the cross. And he died on the cross for you and for me. And when we get to heaven and we are face to face with our Heavenly Father will look to Jesus. And Jesus will say, I died for him. And God will say, welcome home, son. Welcome home, daughter. There's a price that has to be paid. Right? So let's leave the judging to God. What do you say?
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor and say, let God be the judge of that.
God.
Some of you are like saying that humbly. God.
Let's
look at that verses 3 through 5. So Jesus goes on, right? So first of all, he starts off and he says, do not be judged. You do not judge, right? Or you will be measured in how you judge. So then he says, why do you look at the splinter in your brother's eye, but don't notice the beam of wood in your own? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the splinter out of your eye, and look, there's a beam of wood in your own eye. And he calls him hypocrite. He says, first take the beam of wood out of your eye, and then you will see clearly to take the splinter out of your brother's eye. I hate splinters. Anybody get a splinter? Anybody get a metal splinter? Aren't they the best when you pull them out? The metal splinter? Right? I think it burns more when you pull that out than when you got it. Right? So here's the thing. So when you get a splinter, when I get a splinter, I start to dig it out. And it stings a bit as you're pulling it out. But eventually, it comes out and it doesn't bother me anymore. And it's not infected anymore. And it doesn't hurt anymore. And Jesus is saying here in verses 3 through 5, he's saying, why are you pointing out someone else's issues when you have your own issues to deal with? And your issues are not like the splinter that you see in your brother's eye, but you got this big old log stuck in your own eye. I mean, how are you going to help them with the splinter when you can't even help yourself? So we do whatever we can, right? Listen, I just want to talk to some real people here today. We do whatever we can to take the distraction off of us, and we put it on others, don't we? Because, come on, man, aren't we messy people?
Yes.
I'm a mess, right? We are messy people. And we don't want people to be looking at our mess. So in order to deflect, we start putting out other people's junk so that nobody else will see what we're going through. And sometimes when we're hanging with a crowd, to deflect that, we start to be judgmental out loud, don't we?
Yes.
Come on, ladies.
Yes.
You're hanging out with the girls, right? and some girl comes walking by, and all of a sudden you're like, look at her shoes. Ew, those shoes are gross. Right? And then she's like, what did you guys say? Oh, no, girl, we love your shoes. Where'd you get them? I want to get a pair. Dudes, are we the same, though? Are we judgmental? Sometimes we sit there and we're like, and here's the thing about being guys, because we don't really talk behind your back. We just say it to your face. We're just like, hey, man, what's up with your eyebrows, bro? Connect. There's a razor, shaving face or something, you know what I mean? Right? And we're saying it out loud, and we do that, don't we? Just me? We do that. Aren't we people who judge out loud? Sometimes we do, right? But here's the thing. We can also be judgmental with our thoughts as well, where we don't say it out loud. Right? Man, I'm so glad that I don't look like that. Or, who could live in a house like that? Why would you want to live in a house like that? Listen, do we do this? I wonder if we do this to make us feel better about ourselves. I wonder, do we do it to mask our own stuff? Because here's the thing, I want to share something with you. Jesus knows your thoughts. You can't hide your thoughts from him. So listen to what he says in John 7. He says this, stop judging. Thank you, we're done. This sermon's over, okay? Stop judging according to outward appearances. Rather, judge according to righteous judgment. I was asked to do and some of you have heard this story. I was asked to do a sermon for Trudy's brother's sister's, Trudy's brother's wife's mom. And they were bikers. I'm talking Hell's Angel biker kind of bikers, right? You ever been to a biker funeral?
Yes.
It's intense, man, right? And so they asked me to lead it, and I'm like, yeah, right? Because I love Trudy's family, and so I want to be there. And so we're doing it for her mother. Man, we're walking in a line of motorcycles are out there, and they're revving it up, man. And they're right outside the door, and there's nothing like bike exhaust in the house, right? So good. And, you know, I have Jacob with me, so I steal his oxygen so I can at least not get high off his stuff. So we go sit down there, and they're sitting in front of me, and I'm having this conversation, because her name was Charlie, and I knew Charlie. And I'm sharing about Jesus, and I'm sharing about her life, and I'm telling you, man, most of this crowd was drunk, but it was the best church service ever, right? Because I'm sitting there like, hey, man, this is weird, balling. It was, wow. We represented Charlie really well, and we represented Jesus greatly. Now, I remember walking out. We're getting ready to go. It's a Saturday, and we're getting ready to walk out, and the bikes are still going. It's revving, and this young lady comes up to me, and she says to me, she says, wow. Right? I have never heard a pastor speak like you before. I was like, all right. And she says, I want to come to your church. I was like, man, we'd love to have you. We'd love to have you come to our church. We actually, we're meeting tomorrow. And we're at LCCC. We meet at 10 o'clock. You should come. Right? My sister-in-law comes and she's like, man, you're going to love it. You're going to love Jason. You're going to love it. Love it. And so then she starts weeping. This young lady starts weeping. And she goes, but I can't come. I'm like, why? And she says, because I'm going to be hungover tomorrow. I was like, it's cool, man. No, no, no. We got a hungover section at church. Come. Right? Because we are a church that says, come as you are. Come messy. Come messed up. And let Jesus sort it out. And the thing is that we living well, we don't judge you. We love. And that we're concerned about who you are and how you can take a step with Christ. So that Sunday rolled around, and I deserved it.
hung over section. She didn't come. But can I tell you something? I just wanted to love on her.
Amen.
I just wanted her to see Jesus the way I see Jesus. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, let God be the judge of that.
Let God be the judge of that.
Let's end this in verse 6, right? So we come to the end of this part of judgment. And he says, this is an interesting verse that most of us kind of just glaze over. Some of us are kind of like, how does this fit into judging? Let me share it with you, right? So he says this, right? So Jesus gets up, he says, hey man, take the log out of your eye. So he says this, don't give what is holy to dogs or toss your pearls before pigs. Or they will trample them under their feet, turn, and tear you to pieces. Listen to me. I would never take my Bible and place it inside a dog pen and let them trample over it, tear it apart, or anything like that. And why is that? It's because they don't see or know the value of God's words. I would not take my wife's jewelry and throw them into a pig pen where the pigs can trample on them. It's because they don't care about my wife's jewelry, right? Because it's not important to them. And what Jesus is saying here in verse 6, he is saying it is useless to try to teach holy concepts to people who don't want to listen and will tear apart what we say. Listen to me. This doesn't mean that we should stop giving God's word to unbelievers. What it's saying is that we should be wise and we should be discerning in what we teach to whom so that we will not be wasting our time. Let me give you an example. Have you ever spoke to anybody, some folks about Jesus, and all they did was tune you out? Come on, church. Have you ever shared with people or folks how Jesus changed your life and all they did was mock you?
Yes.
Do you ever see those videos, whether it be on YouTube or InstaSnap or Snapgram or YouTube or whatever? You ever see those videos where people are out on the streets and they are speaking, proclaiming God's word, and people just come up to them and scream in their face?
Yeah.
You ever seen those? Anybody on social media? All of you didn't raise your hand, a bunch of liars. You're all on social media, right? Right? And so when you see them, all they're doing is like, yeah, and you're like, ah, right? It's crazy. Listen, some people will never believe in Jesus because their hearts are hardened. And they have ears that don't hear. They have deaf ears to God's word. Listen to what Proverbs 7 or 9, 7 through 8 says this. It says, the one who corrects the mocker will bring abuse on himself. The one who rebukes the wicked will get hurt. Don't rebuke a mocker or he will hate you. Rebuke the wise and he will love you. The difference between a mocker and a wise person lies in the individual's willingness to be corrected. Proverbs 23, 9 says this, don't speak to a fool, for he will despise the inside of your words. This is where we say, teach me. Say, teach me.
Teach me.
This is where we say, teach me good judgment. And teach me discernment, God. But listen, there are folks who will listen. Some of you may know that we have a couple, Jeff and Marnie Willoughby, who go out on the streets every week. And they start telling people about Jesus, handing out tracts, leading people to Jesus. And I went out with Jeff one time. And here we are walking down the street. We're downtown. And there's this lady leaning up against the wall. She's on break. And she's having a cigarette. She's smoking. And Jeff says, hey, I'm going to go talk to her. I was like, absolutely. So he goes over there and he starts talking to her. Listen to this. Long story short, after Jeff was done, this lady gave her life to Jesus by smoking a cigarette on break. It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter what you look like. We're coming.
Yeah.
Right? In the words of Deion Sanders, we're coming. Right? And so here he is. This lady gave her life to Christ on break while smoking a cigarette. During this time, I go across the street, and there was this homeless man just sitting on a bench. And we have material. We're handing out Bibles. We're handing out, you know, the book called Case for Christ. And we're having these conversations. And my approach is, I want to sit down and I want to know you. That's just who I am, right? Maybe that's what I should do to my neighbor. Just sit on my porch until they come out. But I just like to sit down and just get to know them. And this person was homeless and just having this conversation. And long story short, he gave his life to Christ. And he said something that was so profound. He says, nobody ever comes and sits next to me.
Wow.
And he says, why did you come and sit next to me? And I said, it's because I see you. Because Jesus loves you. And that's why I'm here. I don't know what happened to him afterwards. Jeff and I don't know what happened to the lady who's smoking a cigarette. But we do know that when we go to heaven, we'll see him there.
Amen.
I was getting, I had this person come into my office. Asked me to do their wedding. I didn't know them. Asked me if I would perform their wedding. He's like, yeah, let's get to know each other. So he brings his fiance in. They sit in my office. You guys probably heard this story too. There was something off. There was something not right, and I could feel it, and I knew it. And they're just like, just giving me all the 411. It was maybe 15 minutes. I'm like, hey, you know what? Let me have a moment. Just let me pray about this. I'll get back to you. And they stood up. And so they're about to walk out at my door. And the wife or the fiance says, she says, hey, I just want you to know that we're Buddhists. I was like, come on, have a seat. And so when they sat back down, and for 2 hours we talked Jesus. And they gave their life to Christ. And now they are in the community going to a church here in town. They have two kids, and they're just heavily involved in Jesus, right? Listen to me. You don't know who will listen if you don't try. And when it comes to judging others, well, I think we ought to let God be judged.
Right.
So, Heavenly Father.